have come to visit you in peace and with goodwill.
And welcome to Earth versus Soup, episode 41. I'm Aaron Pollyea.
And I'm Darlene.
And we're talking about Project Moonbase from 1953 today.
A black and white found on Amazon Prime.
This was an episode of Mystery Science Theater 3000, and it's an episode that I don't really remember, and I'm going to have to go back and rewatch it because I am sure there's really good riffs for this, being that I joked through most of this movie.
Good thing is it's 63 minutes.
It's okay. So, you know, everyone, you're in for a humdinger when we're both like, the good thing is that it's short. Well, okay, there's more than one good thing, in my opinion, in this movie. But we'll talk about the plot first.
Okay.
And it's very simple, and it's my plots. And I usually get the easy ones for the plot because there's often not a lot of plot.
Well, some of them you wouldn't let me say the very short.
Well, there is no plot. Yeah. But there is a plot. And we should say that this is written by Robert Heinlein.
By Jack Seaman.
Yeah. So there's like two people that wrote this. Jack Seaman on Internet Movie Database has never had another screenplay credit. He was a producer otherwise. So I don't know how much of this I can blame on him. Mainly, you know, I might not like everything that Robert Heinlein has ever done, but generally I consider him a competent writer, a very competent writer.
Like you said, you thought you saw that it was supposed to be like instead of a movie, it was supposed to be a...
Oh, it was a TV pilot.
It was supposed to be a TV
pilot. And then they padded it out to get above 60 minutes so they could be like a B-movie.
Yeah, in that padding.
The padding wasn't as bad as some films that we've watched.
No, it was just the spaceship going.
Yeah, but the padding was more like a minute at a time rather than like 6 minutes of padding, like all put together. And then you have like another minute of plot, then another 6 minutes of padding. This was like... one section of the film had padding.
Yes.
And that's it. Like, all right. But anyway, let's talk about the plot first. This is in the far future year of 1970. It turns out that a space station has been built. But enemies of freedom, i.e. communists, have been trying to destroy the space station because they don't want freedom getting to the moon. It was kind of a ridiculous text crawl at the beginning, but it did one thing well. It said that in 1966, was it, that the first person made it into orbit, a Colonel Bright Eyes. And, okay, so we have this crawl, and it goes to, I don't know, it's very hard to tell. It's clear that the people that are the bad guys are supposed to be like communist agents, but it's never said. I just have to assume that. It's 1953. That's who these people are.
You were assuming. I was taking it as corporations.
Oh, you think it's corporations?
Yes. I thought it was corporations. And that's why I said I looked at you and I went, well, that's treason.
Well, it's because they all sound American, but I'm assuming that they're communists. They're communist agents because they're the enemies of freedom. It's America that they're in. And the corporations are in bed with the American government. Like, I don't know.
Okay.
So folks, what we can say is that it's not clear who the bad guys are, except that they are enemies of freedom. We have a meeting with this guy that is a minister. They refer to him as a minister. Again, this is why I assume it's communists. And they basically come to the conclusion that they have to get a mission off to destroy this space station within 24 hours. And I think that does not work because it's this false time, you know, there's a countdown now, but there doesn't need to be a countdown because you've just literally established the movie. You could just say, hey, we have this opportunity to destroy the space station. Let's take it. But you're putting in this countdown that's immediately in the show, and it doesn't really matter.
It didn't give it.
It didn't give it any sense of urgency. Yeah. No urgency at all. They discover that there's a man named Werner.
Dr. Werner.
Okay, so I guess that's supposed to be like Werner von Braun, but regardless. And he's found in San Francisco, and it turns out that these people have an agent already in San Francisco that is effectively a body double of Dr. Werner. The only difference is that his hair is darker. So they come up with this plan to basically take out the original Werner and replace him with their duplicate.
There was a later on, after they took out the regular doctor, they had said, well, it took us a year to find you.
And that doesn't really make sense with what was going on in the beginning of the film. So they replaced Dr. Werner, and in a hotel, and he gets in a car to go out to like the rocket base, wherever that is. See, he was in San Francisco. So where's the rocket base? I don't know.
But they got an official government car
to drive them out there.
You never saw it. All you saw was the bellboy taking the suitcases and him grabbing the briefcase that was still open as he went out the door.
So we go out to this rocket pad. I kind of consider it a rocket port, and I guess the matte painting is okay for this.
Well, it's supposed to be U.S. SPACOM.
Space Command.
SPACOM.
Yeah, it's Space Command. That's what it is. It's Space Command. Anyway, it turns out that the general in charge of this base he's called General Green, but that's not what I call him, because it's the same guy that played Dr. Bellows from I Dream a Genie. And that's all I know this guy from.
He's supposed to be a general.
He's a general, but to me, that's Dr. Bellows from I Dream a Genie.
Aaron, stop putting him in other characters. Okay. He is Dr. Green.
General Green. He's not here. Dr. Bellows. I just can't. Okay, look, I love I Dream a Genie.
And sorry.
Yeah, I know. I will refer to him as Dr. Bellows.
He looks young in this.
Yeah, he is. This is 1953, so this is pretty well in advance of I Dream a Genie. So yeah, he is younger in this. He calls in Colonel Bright Eyes, the first American, the first person in space.
No, he's talking to Major Bill Moore.
Well, yeah, and Bill, you're right. Major Moore is his name, Bill Moore.
Bill Moore.
And he's kind of a dick. Bill Moore comes off as a dick.
Well, so is the general.
The general comes off as a dick, which is weird. There's a lot of like insubordinate talk between them, but it's not that bad. You're like, okay, well, it's probably because these two guys have known each other for a while, and one of them is ticked, and it seems like it's the major. It seems like it's the major. The general's just like, I'm doing my job. I can't help it. Why don't you leave the room? Because I'm going to talk to Colonel Bright Eyes, because I have to put Colonel Bright Eyes in charge of this.
And then he sets her down.
Yeah, well, Bright Eyes is a woman. Yes. Okay, and you're like, oh, okay, so I see. This is where Robert Heinlein comes through, because a lot of what Robert Heinlein was doing way back in the day was equality of the sexes.
But the director really,
There's other problems that arise, because I think what Robert Heinlein originally had, you can see some of the Heinlein coming through, and remember, Heinlein gets top writing credit in this. But it really feels like the plot was mangled badly, because Bright Eyes is a woman and there's nothing wrong with that. But here's the thing. She wasn't the first human being in space because of her skill or even because of her gender.
That's what they come across.
Well, no, yeah, because they're like, the only reason we sent you...
Because she was 95 pounds, but he might have been just being an ass.
He might have been, but she didn't take it that way. She just kind of took that and nodded. Like, it wasn't specifically said that that was the reason. Well, that and it could have been the general being an ass, absolutely. But he said, the only reason I sent you and not Major Moore... Was because you were 95 pounds and he's 180. So now you got the promotion. You're the hero. And you get to take command of this mission and then treat him well. So it's like, whoa, wait a second. I had to pause the movie and I looked over to Darlene and I said, Heinlein either got butchered here or I don't know, because it came off as really sexist.
Really sexist, really... degrading
to her,
but yeah. Then her acting was childlike
because she just she walked in and had this big attitude, and
the directing had to been crap and the wording had to been rewritten because it just did not.
Well, I just don't want to do that, General, you know, like things like that, and it's holy crap, shut up. You're getting an order.
A colonel was getting an order. Now,
and she came in dressed down.
She was dressed.
Her uniform was all screwed open. Up. Yeah, open.
Mm-hmm. And why would you have a jacket that has a zipper?
It's okay. I will be okay with that because it's Space Force, so it's more like a jumpsuit.
There is a jacket that we in the Air Force had that was a zipper, but that was an outside jacket.
Okay, totally different decade.
And you would unzip it and have it unzipped a bit.
Yeah. No, I know what you're saying. And
you take it off, but theirs was zipped up.
Yes.
And it looked tacky.
Okay, granted, I will give you that. But what I'm saying is that all the men kept their jumpsuits zipped up, and it looked sort of like a uniform because of the medals and things.
But again, it could have been the director going, show your boobies.
Yes, because they kind of do that through this movie. And yes. I don't think that's very Heinlein-ish. Maybe I'm giving Heinlein too much credit, but regardless.
He was a sexist.
I don't know. Darlene, don't put that label on him.
He liked.
No. I'm interrupting you because. Okay, so Heinlein has his issues.
Yes.
Okay, he does have an obsession with sex. That doesn't mean he's a sexist.
Okay.
What I'm trying to say is that the stuff that came out in this meeting was derogatory towards Colonel Bright Eyes. Bright Eyes was insubordinate for no good reason to the general, and
the major all the way through it is insubordinate to her.
Yeah, there is no military. There is no good conduct occurring in this movie. And it gets worse later on. See, we've kind of drifted from the plot, but the point is that this scene with the general and Colonel Bright Eyes is kind of emblematic of a lot of the problems in this film. That it seems like here we're gonna have this normal situation where there's a colonel and a general that don't get along. The colonel has to go out on this mission. The colonel doesn't really like the general. But instead of coming down to like this difference in ideas or difference in personality, it basically boils down to
she's a woman. I think the general was supposed to not like her. She didn't care about whether she just didn't want Major there because Major was going to be a
dick. But remember, like, how does the general respond to it? Not that, you know, I'll bust you down a rank. I'll put you up in front of a board for insubordination. No, he says, I'll bend you over my knee and give you a good spanking. Like, yes. What the hell? What the hell? This is not acceptable. And that's exactly what I said when we were watching it.
And he was putting Major into the position of her co-pilot. Not on the recommendation of the headquarters. He was sliding that in underneath the stuff by taking this other guy out and putting him as
So my notes say this entire conversation, this entire scene is really unprofessional, derogatory, and sexist. And it's so in contrast with the fact that there is a woman in command of this very important mission. It shows that there are basically two writers here struggling against each other.
Yeah, there was two writers.
Okay, so what we do is we launch this rocket into space. This Werner replicant is on board, the colonel and the major. They have this high gravity launch that seems insane.
Oh, and there is at that point we have a gravimeter and something that looks like an elevator switchboard.
Yeah, the gravimeter has dashes on it, but no numbers, no labels, and it just spins wildly. Like, how in the hell are you supposed to?
And the elevator thing has got numbers 1, 2, 3. You know, like an elevator.
That's
would.
Like a thrust meter.
And
it goes
up by 3, and the next level, level.
So it looks like, to me, what it looks like is that the rocket is accelerating up off the ground at like 1,000 G's. Basically, that's what it looks like. And the two men are just screaming in their seats, right, in their recliners. And me and Colonel Bright Eyes is just kind of like swooning a little in her seat. And I'm like, they're not accelerating because her bra is so pointy. she doesn't even look like she's accelerating.
Oh,
and of course
we didn't talk about their costumes.
Yeah, their costumes are
right
sexist.
Right out of Flash Gordon, crapping cap of Flash Gordon.
And here's why I say their costumes are sexist. They're the exact same costumes for the men and the women. The difference is that on men, it tends to not show their assets, where on a woman, the tight shirts clearly show...
The tight t-shirt.
And the short shorts tend
to... That are folded up on her?
Yep, so they can't look up her shorts when she's on the elevator.
So they look like, pantaloons
because
the 1950s.
Colonel Bright Eyes is played by Donna Martell, and she is an attractive woman. She is. And the bra that they gave her, it's one of those that I call like torpedo bras from the 50s. And...
Did you look at a picture of her in normal?
Yeah.
Did she have that big of
a chest? I mean, yeah, but I mean, they're not that pointy. Let's put it that way.
Okay. So it's just one of those cross your heart.
It's a style of, but the thing, why I'm bringing this up again is not to point out her breasts, because there's only a couple movies that we've watched that I'm like, we need to point out her breasts. Like Mimi Van Doren in Navy versus the Night Monsters, you're like, okay, we have to talk about Mimi's breasts here because
they're in the way.
Hers Donna Martell's
in your face.
Exactly. That's the point, that the costume effectively makes her breasts constantly in the center of frame when she's on screen and facing even somewhat towards the camera. And because of the way her shirt fits and the costume is, you, as a man, as a heterosexual male or someone who is interested in females that way, you cannot help but sit there and look.
It was hard not to notice, even being a female, that is heterosexual.
Yeah. So I didn't look at the eye lines for the guys, the actors in this, but I can't think that they did multiple takes, because they had to have been like hard to look away because of how weird that costume is. Anyway, they dock at a space station.
But why? There was also Rocket 3 went up first.
Yeah, that had the general on it, if you didn't remember. That had like the general and a couple of his
staff.
Then
there was Rocket 63 with
Which
the
was,
three of them.
Yeah.
Colonel Bright Eyes, Major Moore, and Dr. Winner. And they never tell us why there needs to be this doctor.
Oh, no, they do. They do. They actually say that this mission is to go around the moon and photograph the rear side of the moon to look for places to land for the manned mission to the moon. Okay, because it's 1970, but in this timeline, the manned mission, the Apollo missions haven't happened. Okay, so Werner is there because he's a photographic expert. He knows how to operate these pieces of technology. So I paid attention to that. There's a reason for him to be there.
I was like, why are they bringing in this doctor?
So they dock at this space station, and we have a scene where the major and the colonel go onto the space station and have a meeting. And we're going to have to talk about that after we get done with the plot, because there's things that are actually cool in this and incredibly aggravating to me from a scientific point of view.
Yes.
Okay. So they get sent out, and it comes out that this imposter Dr. Werner, they leave, by the way. They leave the space station. They go on this like exploratory craft to go into orbit around the moon. The imposter is so incompetent.
He doesn't even know that
he doesn't know his ledger.
His character that he's supposed to be portraying is
from Brooklyn.
Boston.
Brooklyn. Dodgers. Brooklyn? Yeah, Brooklyn Dodgers.
Okay.
Was the
and
line.
They were supposed to, he was like, Moore asked him about wanting to get back and watch the game.
The World Series.
And he goes, oh, that's right. You would be for the Dodgers.
And he's like, okay, what? Who? Yeah, and he doesn't know who the goddamn Okay, so you have a spy that is completely incompetent and so incompetent that he doesn't even know how to use the camera equipment.
Yes, he doesn't know how to use the
But
he is asking questions about the navigation.
So, Darlene, I would actually say that the evidence of how incompetent this guy is suggests that it isn't the Soviets doing this, because the Soviets were actually competent with their espionage, you know, their espionage programs. They actually were. This had to have been. This is evidence.
But Mr. Roundtree sound very competent. The person that put him in the place. No,
well, he's clearly not. If he allowed a completely untrained, unbriefed spy to get onto this,
yes.
So, I mean, I would say, okay, this suggests more like some incompetent traitors in the U.S. government or a corporation. I would say that's a piece of evidence for that, because there's no way the Soviets would be this incompetent. So he's found out almost instantly after they leave the space station, and they get into a fight, and Werner triggers the rockets on the space probe, and it accelerates. Major Moore takes him out, effectively knocks him unconscious, and it turns out that they've put themselves into a position, which I don't understand this, that they have to land on the moon. That there's no way not to land on the moon. Okay?
Run out of fuel.
They're out of fuel once they get onto the surface. And okay, I guess, but you're in like a high lunar orbit. At least that's what it suggested to me. It didn't make a whole lot of sense, but fine, we're going with it, right? Maybe you were on like it accelerated you to the point where you didn't have the time to do anything but zero out your velocity at the surface, and that's all you had. Okay, I guess I could buy that. So they land on the moon. And they do so via seemingly their computer, because they're not really doing any controls themselves. So that means that this thing was programmed to actually land on the moon properly, and it has
I think from what I was kind of getting was, I think that was supposed to be the lander.
I think it was supposed to be the future lander, because it has legs.
Yes.
And you shouldn't have actually designed that spacecraft with legs unless you weren't planning on using it to land on the moon. So, I mean, again, I guess I can buy it that it could land.
Then the next stuff comes in that is so stupid.
Okay, so it turns out that where they landed, I don't know, this is okay.
It's a crater.
They landed in a crater, that's fine. It turns out where they landed is in a radio shadow to the space station and Earth. Again, you were like, what? And I'm like, no, actually, that makes sense, especially if the space station is at like a Lagrange point between the Earth and the moon. And that means that it's always going to be sitting in the same part of the lunar sky. And that means the Earth, remember, the moon's tidally locked, so the Earth always sits at the same point. So that means if they landed at a certain part of the moon, like the dark, you know, the rear side, the far side of the moon.
But they were definitely in sun.
It doesn't matter. The sun goes on every part of the moon. Moon rotates. It just rotates at the same speed as it revolves. Anyway, there's portions of the moon that unless you have a satellite that's orbiting the moon as well, that is going to be in the radio shadow. Okay.
And so that made sense. Why didn't they send that up first?
Now, where it breaks down is the fact that let me get what they have to do. So the colonel figures out that you have to go out and set up this radio equipment on one of the peaks around the edge of the crater. This makes sense again.
Okay.
And we're going to use it as a relay to get in contact with the space station so they can send a rescue team.
And okay. He takes Werner.
The Werner imposter, because they need to have, he needs to have help carrying the equipment. Again, okay, I get it. They use the same spacesuits from Destination Moon, the George Pal film from episode one.
I don't know if it's the same.
It is.
Because all of them look kind of the same.
Even it is. That's fine. You say they all look the same. I know there's at least three movies that we've watched out of now 41 that have used that specific spacesuit. The helmets are different. Fair enough. Anyway, they go out and they climb this mountain and set up the radio things. Now, at the top, this is where I start getting like, what's going on here? You see the Earth behind them, that big curve. And I'm like, wait.
But it's white.
But it doesn't matter. It's black and white film. It's overexposed. Big deal. But if you can see the Earth like that, you're not in the radio shadow. There's communication satellites. Anyway.
Keep going.
Keep going at the plot. The imposter falls down this peak that they were on at the edge of the crater. It looked like to me he fell accident. It was an accident. And he hits the ground and dies. And Bill doesn't even, it's Bill, yeah. Bill doesn't even bring back the body.
He just leaves the body cramped. Why would he when he's getting tired when he walks back?
Yeah, that actually makes sense.
He's losing oxygen or something.
Well, no, it's not that he's losing oxygen. It's just that they only had 4 hours worth of supply. And it took them basically 2 hours to get there and 2 hours back. So, yeah, it makes sense. I guess he's like, I cannot waste time dragging this guy's body back. I have to go. So he leaves the body behind, gets back to the rocket, and gets in contact. They all get in contact with the space station.
Yeah, and you forgot the little trapeze.
Yeah, the rocket has like a little elevator that they sit in, and it just like kind of lowers them to the ground. It's not an elevator. It's like
a trapeze.
It just kind of lowers them to the ground. I'm like, okay, that's kind of cute. I mean,
but when they went up,
it was a little miniature and it looked really bad. Or are you talking about when they got into the rocket on the ground? But remember, this was a different rocket. This was the lander. This was a different rocket that they went up. So they get in contact with the general on the space station. They're like, okay, hold on. I got in contact with the president. We're calling you Moonbase 1, and you're going to have to stay there and ration your food and water.
But we got a slight problem.
Yeah, we got a slight problem. There's political things to be dealt with here. There's some problems. And the problem basically is that this is really unprofessional, and it's the president and the general feel that it is necessary, since there's a man and a woman on the moon, that they need to be married for media or political reasons. I don't understand this. And the general's really pushy about it.
Yeah, and condescending too.
Yeah, and condescending. And he's like, he's talking to the major and has the colonel get out of the room.
Yes.
And he's like, you're really attracted to her, aren't you? She's a pretty woman. You know, you're going to be trapped up there for at least a few months. And it's like, what the
shit? Where the crap do they have the oxygen and the...
Well, no. It's from... Darlene, it's not this. It's the fact that, like, they're... The general is trying to, like...
But in my mind, I'm sitting there going, how are they going to stay there, even before this? How are they going to stay there 3 or 4 months?
Well, they're getting a supply rocket. That's what that little drone rocket is at the end. But this is all, like, within the, like, last 8 minutes of the film.
Yes.
That, like, the general basically pressures them into marrying and having sex on the moon.
Ugh.
And he marries them via, like, conference call.
And Madam President.
And then, like, the Mrs. Madam President, a female president, which, again, I think is, like, one of those things that Heinlein probably put in, is then very happy that there's a married couple on the moon, and maybe, I don't know. I don't know what her deal is. Like, she's just happy that there's a base on the moon, and there might be people going up there to stay with them at some point, but at least now there's a married couple of Americans on the moon. The end. That's the plot. And
two people that probably wanted to kill each other are now married.
The problems with this movie basically center around the incredible sexist crap that happens in this movie, the insubordination, the awful way the characters treat each other.
Yeah, and there is no way that if I was, you know, being treated like that from this guy, I don't know who's jealous of who. It seemed like Bill was jealous of
Bright Eyes. Yes. No, I agree. He was.
And if I was being treated like that, I would not want to marry the person. I would want to...
Yeah, get the hell out. Yeah,
keep, like, as much professionalism between me and him.
Yeah, but now, okay, you were in the Air Force. Are you allowed to have a relationship with somebody in your chain of command?
No.
Okay. I knew that answer.
They move you out of that position.
Because why? Why is that a problem, Darlene?
Conflict of interest.
Yes. Conflict of interest. Exactly. See, I knew these answers, but I wanted to have you say it because you were in the Air Force. Because,
for instance, an NCO could marry an officer, but they can't be under that...
In that chain of command. Yes. There are two people on the moon who are in direct chain of command with each other. And they get married. And it's very clear that the superior officer, who is Bright Eyes, is the one that's being shit on by everybody all the time. Anyway,
go back to the one part we had of the space station.
Okay, I need to talk about the space station because there's actually a cool thing on it.
Can I say something?
Sure.
Don't do Dutch angles.
Yeah, a lot of the scenes that were on the space station had Dutch angles, and it was just aggravating because it wasn't like for an artistic reason. It was for to like say, oh, look, there's no up or down. But a lot of the stuff in this is up and down.
When you walked into the thing, there's a person walking down the hallway. The wall says...
Okay. The wall has a sign that says, please do not walk on the walls.
And on one side, it's facing... It's down, like, well, and the other one it's facing if you were up on the ceiling, you'd be reading it correctly.
Yes. So the issue is that there is no up and down in space. Fine. It's that there is no relative up or down in the space station. And that is what causes me a problem. And the reason is that human beings are generally, we have evolved on a world where gravity is pulling our feet down towards the ground, right?
And our head is up.
And we tend to talk to each other and in a certain direction. We look at each other up and down. Now, to test what I'm saying here, go and talk to somebody hanging upside down somewhere. Like just on a jungle gym or have one of your kids like just go upside down on the couch and have a conversation with them and see how fun it is.
Oh, and there's this room that they go to talk to their superiors.
I'm getting there. Hold on. I'm getting there. My point is that
they have a conversation with somebody that's standing on the ceiling and they're on the floor.
And you know what? That's a single scene. That's fine. The point is that there's all these signs in these large corridors on a circular station that is for some reason not rotating and producing
gravity,
like, you know, through rotational gravity, that there's no up or down. There's no like rhyme or reason to any of it. And you're not allowed to walk on the walls. Well, fine. Why aren't you allowed to walk on the walls if you're allowed to walk on
the ceiling,
the floor and ceiling? Well, because there's no doors there, but there are.
We and both see that. Sides have about a foot step up, whether you're on whichever side.
Yeah. And okay. So it's a neat thing to show that there's no up or down in space.
And I fine. Will give it to this. The general wasn't crappy to the reporter, Patty or whatever her name was.
Yeah.
He wasn't crappy to her in the conversation and explained the no weight situation and that they have mag boots.
Again, that was, I think, Heinlein. That had to have been Heinlein trying to actually accurately talk about how orbit works and how there's no weight, but there is mass. I don't know. Anyway. Again, Destination Moon did it far better. But we go into the scene with the general on the space station where they walk on the wall.
So, no, they sit down on the wall.
So the general and his staff are on the floor, the relative floor, let's say. But Bright Eyes and the major are on the wall.
In chairs that are on the wall.
Now, here's the issue. All of the characters at this point are basically having to look up at each other from their own perspective, looking up at from where they normally would be looking level at somebody talking across from them. They're all craning their necks to talk to each other.
Yeah, that would be ridiculous.
It's ridiculous. Why don't you just put all of your chairs on the same freaking relative level. Floor?
And then you'd want to like paint green and blue.
Yeah, so that's my going theory that I've like talked about. Not theory. It's my going idea that on any long-term space voyage or large space station, because the International Space Station doesn't have large spaces that would need this, but you would want to paint your floor, and I'm putting floor in air quotes that you can't see. You want to paint your floor green and your ceiling blue.
Or have it brown and then white on the ceiling.
Yeah, to show ground and sky. That this is the down, there is the up, right? It makes everybody feel more grounded and has a sense of normality in a very alien environment.
And you wouldn't have to write, no walking on walls.
Because everyone would be walking on the floor. All right, so the things that work in this movie. We've already kind of griped about a lot of the stuff that didn't work. But what worked was I thought it was very cute having that sign, please don't walk on walls. I thought that was cute. I was like, okay, I'm down with that. That's funny. I thought the rockets looked pretty good. I liked the fact that they actually had acceleration couches. Again, not all of these films do, but some
even
of them
that we've
watched.
Even though they looked like something that was a lawn?
Yeah, at least they did that.
Yes, and there did look like a lawn chair.
We've had movies. Most of the movies that we've watched, actually, out of these 41 that we've done so far, have had acceleration couches, and I hope that I've mentioned that that's a positive in all of them, because it's something that is, to me, legit and good to have. I think that's all to me that worked, because I don't think the acting really worked in this. The characters are just either aggravating or you want to throttle them. Can you think of anything else that worked to you? She yawns.
What works?
I said a few of the things.
I like the you said the space station was something from something else.
I swear I've seen that space station
before. I can't remember anything like that.
I swear.
But I've all seen it looks station. Like is a flat pancake.
Yeah.
And I still, well, we know today we wouldn't make something like that. We would actually
build a ring station or something.
We'd do a ring station where it would spin.
And that thing should have been spinning. It should have been, because it's round. It would have produced, you know, rotational gravity, and people wouldn't be floating around and having weird arguments about up or down and don't walk on the damn walls.
Yeah,
there wouldn't be that problem. But anyway,
you know, I think they were using a space station, a saucer, because it looks kind of saucer.
Yeah, it's a saucer
with four outlets.
Yeah.
It was kind of neat that they had to go in, but I was like, ooh, that would have pushed the doggone station.
And I said, that's why you have RCS thrusters. you did say there was one thing that you liked while we were watching it that you haven't mentioned.
What?
The little rocket ship with the moon logo.
They had on their... I did have this written down. They have a moon and rocket on their uniform.
Yeah, and it's like an embroidered...
It's embroidered. And it was on their first uniform.
The jumpsuits
in the office that we talked about earlier being a total.
That whole scene was a shit show.
Yeah.
Yeah. No. But it's supposed to be like pilots' wings or astronauts'
wings. And they had it on their helmet.
Their jumpsuit, the costumes that they had while on the rocket, folks, are the ones that we're talking
about. It looked like Ming the Merciless.
Oh, it was very King, Flash Gordon.
But it looked like it was felt with gold.
Gold trim.
Gold trim on it.
If you do a Google image search for this movie, you know, you are going to see them in that costume.
And it's crappy shorts.
The short shorts. And the super tight shirts.
They rolled hers up to make them shorter.
Not by much, darling. No, not by much. You're giving me a look, but it wasn't by much. And the only reason they did that was so they couldn't look up her shorts when she was climbing.
Okay, we'll leave it there.
Because otherwise, it was a little loose, and you probably could have seen upper shorts.
Yeah, because they're just explorer pants.
Yeah, they're just like little explorer shorts. Yeah, I mean. Yeah, it's, I don't know. I'm not going to recommend this movie.
No, I wouldn't either.
It's pretty awful just because of the way that they treat each other in this. And then it's uncomfortably
and there's
sexist.
There is no charisma between any of them. The only character that I thought was likable was the the reporter. And that's the only one that came off as any decent person.
The reporter? Yeah, I agree. And the only other character that I think I had absolutely any connection to at all was the general, and that's just because he played Dr. Bellows in I Dream a Genie, because his character was awful. But I smiled every time I saw him on screen because he's Dr. Bellows from I Dream a Genie.
You can't take another place into
that.
Another movie and give
I'm just
credit
saying,
for that.
I'm just saying that that's the only other thing character-wise or actor-wise that I thought...
Were all these beginning actors at this point in time?
No, they already had careers before this.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean, there aren't like super young actors or actresses in this, but yeah, no, none of the actors had chemistry together.
And
the plot is...
This plot is like some 12-year-old wrote it.
And this is Heinlein. That's the thing. This
I
is
don't
Heinlein.
Think it was him. I really think it's
he
this Jack.
He has top billing.
I wouldn't be embarrassed if I...
No, and here's the thing. Remember, this was supposed to be a TV pilot. So I can guarantee you that Heinlein probably originally wrote a much more tight script.
Yes.
that was probably heavily changed after the fact to turn it into a 63-minute piece.
By that Jack Seaman.
Who was a producer on other films, but never
wasn't he the producer here?
Was he? Now I have to look. He did the screenplay, Jack Seaman. Producer, yeah, Project Moonbase. This is his last producing credit as well. Otherwise, he did like Cattle Queens, Border Outlaws, Detour to Danger. That's a great title, Detour to Danger. Jeep Herders. They're herding Willis Jeeps.
Wow.
Actually, that would actually be a very cool movie if it actually was. Oh man, what a great movie poster. Check out Jeep Herders, guys. That's awesome. Wildcat Oil Outfit is seeking to take over the ranch belonging to Pop Martin and his son Bob and daughter Helen. Sends his ex-army pals a stay away message. Yeah, but they're not herding Jeeps. That's a shame.
Here. Jeepy.
It's the prequel to Christine.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, yeah, we're getting off the movie track. But yeah, we don't recommend it. I don't think there's anything here that a modern movie producer could learn from this.
No.
Because it's so basic. It's so... I don't know. It's very forgettable, except for the rampant sexism, which is shocking in these films, and it's shocking for Heinlein.
Yeah.
And that makes me think Heinlein didn't write those parts. Like, it had to have been, like, this other guy, or...
He wrote the premise, maybe?
He wouldn't get top billing for that. Because, you see, look, Heinlein got not only...
Maybe they were using his name.
Look, he got both credit for the screenplay and story. Heinlein. So he came up with the concept and wrote the screenplay.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's tough. I don't know. So I guess the only reason I would ever say for somebody to watch this is if you want to have the full Heinlein experience. Like, if you're really into Heinlein and you want to watch everything that he was involved with.
No, because it doesn't feel like his.
No, of course it doesn't. But yeah, it's crazy, isn't it? Like, anyway, Destination Moon was far better and had Heinlein in it, and it was George Pal. You know, why he did this, I don't know. But again, we're talking about Project Moonbase. We've talked about Project Moonbase from 1953. We hope you enjoyed listening. I'm Aaron Pollyea.
I'm Darlene. Good night.
Good night. Have a nice night.
At no point in your rambling, incoherent response were you even close to anything that could be considered a rational thought.
Thanks for listening to this episode of This Week in Geek. Hungry for more? Check out our website at thisweekingeek.net. You can subscribe to the podcast, browse our Twitter and Instagram, and leave your thoughts on today's topics. If you'd like to give us some feedback, send us an email at feedback@thisweekingeek.net. Tune in next time, and remember,
lower your shields and surrender your listenership.
We would be honored if you would join us.
Thank you for your cooperation. Good night.